So, yeah, so some of the stuff is like when they're doing something naughty, it's more to think about how can I actually prevent this from happening mm-hmm. the next time by mm-hmm. asking them to do a down stay okay. or by throwing treats on the floor before they start jumping on me mm-hmm. or leave it as one that it's helpful for them to
yeah.
know the word. But even leave it, people don't realize that you can say it really early. So some people, a lot of people say leave it when the dog's mouth is like practically
what they
don't want
to
have. If you paying attention, you could see them actually see something from like 10 feet away that they're
yeah.
going for, and that's a really good time to say
yeah.
leave it. So
that's what I try to do with Steve, because I can tell when he's about to bark, he gets tense, and I'll be like, leave it. Yeah. Sometimes I can, you know, get his mind off of whatever he's, you know, focused on by saying leave it. So before he does the barking, but as you saw, it doesn't always work.
Yeah. Well, how old is Steve?
Steve is, we think, a little over 3.
Oh, he's still young.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was thinking too, like, he might also be doing a bit of like mimicking or copycatting of Steve's
mm-hmm.
behavior.
I know.
No, I know, and it's not your fault. I know, but it's just something to think that is totally
yeah
common.
Yeah. And the thing with the like, I like the idea of, like, throwing all the treats around, but it worries me if they're both out.
Yeah, you definitely...
I don't want them to, like, both go after a piece and then...
Yeah, absolutely. No matter what, it's the most important to think about safety.
Mm-hmm.
Think about safety first and training second.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you think about, like, management stuff, definitely, yeah, like, you're already doing the feeding separate, keeping up the toys, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
Only bringing toys out when one or the other... can just play with you one-on-one
mm-hmm.
with the
mm-hmm.
toy. And I would say, yeah, when you're preparing the food
mm-hmm.
and you want to work on a down stay
mm-hmm.
or not jumping up.
They're actually doing well. I should say this. Steve sits and just stares at me. Like, he is like, I know that this is coming. And he sees whatever Charlie's doing is, I don't like it. So he's actually... Steve has actually been more well-behaved.
That's good.
Because when before we got Charlie, Steve would actually whine when I was making
food. But he's gotten better.
Now he'll just go over by the door. Like, I'll be in the corner of the kitchen, and he'll just go over by the door, and he'll just sit and watch me. And then Charlie will be kind of jumpy, but he's, I think, taking cues from Steve that, like, oh, she doesn't like this.
Yeah. Yeah, they definitely... Yeah, take cues off of other dogs. And sometimes it's for the better, and sometimes it's for the
yes.
worse.
Yes.
So, have you done any? I know he doesn't have all his shots yet. So,
mm-hmm.
He's basically just been either in your house or other people's houses that have been helping with him.
Yeah.
But not like any sort of walking around.
No,
but,
we
yeah.
will let him out in the yard to, you know, run around with Steve. Like, that's kind of our morning routine. As we get up, we go outside, we go potty. Once you've pottied, then I'll make some food. Once we eat, we go right back out for more pottying and then play. So hopefully I can keep them out there running around after each other for like an hour is the goal.
Get rid of some of that early
yes.
early day
yes.
energy. So that's good that he's only basically guarding his food, and it could possibly be not necessarily the food, but the fact that he's not sure about your boyfriend and that he got up and got into his line of vision. But
mm-hmm.
I think no matter what, a Kong or a food puzzle toy will help because of the way he's wanting to eat so
right.
quickly. I think
right.
it'll really be good for him to have a different way to eat. So, but it is good that he's not, like, guarding tons of other stuff.
Yeah, no, that seems to be really it. It's just mostly the food.
Okay, good. And then you mentioned your lap. Is that just towards Steve?
Yeah. So Steve is my little guy. He's always just wants to be on me, touching me all the time. And so when this little guy came in, he was like, whoa, what is going on? So Steve, like, if he is on my lap and Charlie just wants to come in for the action, you know, he doesn't care that Steve is there.
Mm-hmm.
But Steve will, like, kind of snap, like...
Oh, so it's Steve who guards your lap.
Steve will kind of guard my lap, but Charlie wants to always be on my lap.
Both
so it's, yeah, so it's been, like, kind of a thing where Steve is just now sort of resigned that, like, all right, I'm going to sit on this side of the couch and they're going to sit over there and snuggle, and I don't get to snuggle with my mom. So what we've kind of tried to do is have, you know, Brendan in the spare room to sleep with Charlie. So he does get to sleep with someone in his cuddle, but then I get to have, like, alone time with Steve.
Okay, good.
Because Steve usually sleeps in the bed with us.
Yeah.
So.
So it has never been the other way around. It's never been Charlie on your lap and Charlie...
No. No, he's not...
Okay.
No.
Okay.
No. I think it's more a thing with Steve. And then Charlie feels that aggression and has, you know, gotten, I think, upset back at Steve.
Defensive.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I just didn't want Steve teaching him bad habits.
Yeah.
Because Steve gets a little...
And sometimes it's a fine line. I mean, sometimes an older dog just needs to tell a younger dog, get back a few times. But then it can also, then it can quickly teeter into the puppy not reading that right.
Yeah.
Or getting upset back, and that's not what you want. So if they're just like, oh, okay, and they back off and that's fine, then that's one thing. But if it starts to become...
I've kind of tried to let them, like, feel each other out, and, like you said, kind of just, because I know that there's a pecking order, you know, and this is Steve's house, and he, you know, we're his mommy, and these are his toys, and all of that, so I've kind of tried to let them, you know, explain to each other how, you know, how it's going to work, but yeah, like you said, always just kind of watching and very close by, because I've seen it flip, you know, where... You know, they're playing and they're having a good time, and then all of a sudden, you know, Charlie will put a paw on Steve's back or something so that Steve's, and it'll help the flip the switch and just, like, make the terrible gremlin noises I was talking about.
So, yeah, and that's another thing to just think about. If they're playing, you know, Steve might have a limit. So if you can think about watching the clock a little bit, you might say, hey, after 40 minutes, that's it for Steve, and he starts to get snappy. So maybe next time... cut off play around that time. And it could be, you know, different day to day or different, you know, morning to evening or whatever. So yeah, but definitely, like, the lap thing, I think I would try to avoid it, like you've done, have lap time be done when not both dogs are in the room. So a lot of that stuff, dog interactions are really best just managed, like you have with,
and they've gotten better at, like, because at first it was like one's got to be on this side, and then one's sitting with me on the whole other end of the couch, and now it's like, you can have this side, and you can have this side, and we can touch each other, and it's fine. So they're getting, they're getting used to each other.
That's great.
I think Steve was actually looking for him when I took him over to the other girl's house last night.
Wondering where he went.
Yeah, like, he was kind of, like, dancing around from room to room. He, like, went in the crate, like, where is this guy? Looking for him outside, I thought, too. So... he likes him, I think.
Well, sometimes, I mean, and it's still so new. Sometimes over time, sometimes dogs really get to love and enjoy each other, and but sometimes tension builds. So it goes both ways, but the way you're managing everything carefully is a really good way to set them up for success. So probably the most important thing that you wanted me to come help with today is his fear of strangers, I think. And if you want him to have a forever home, that's really important to people. And just for his life in general, in the future. So,
well, because whoever adopts him, like, once he's okay with them, like, then every time they have people over, it's going to be like Steve with his barking.
Yeah, and you don't want that. And also...
but even scarier, because it's almost like charging, like, snarling behavior, and he's... probably a pit bull, and he's probably going to get pretty
big. He'll get bigger, a lot bigger. Yeah, so the important thing to think about with fearful dogs is when you work on changing that mindset is that all they need to do is feel better about it. So they don't need to do anything. They don't need to sit. They don't need to stay. They don't need to, you know, get down or get off or do anything. All, like, it's the same way we work with reactive dogs. When they're lunging on the leash, it's not, oh, you need to be quiet. So they, it's not like you need to learn a be quiet command. It's like, all you need to do is feel better about the situation. So the way that I would have a fearful dog meet new people is to ask people to completely ignore the dog, not to look at them, not to talk to them. It's best to be sitting down at first and then build up to being able to get up and sit down. So, and then... then if you start tossing treats on the floor, and of course you'd need to be alone for that, so there's no competition.
Yeah.
that really helps them learn being around this person is actually not so bad. Good things come when I'm around this person. And you have to think about their threshold. So some dogs, you know, it's 10 feet away. It's a comfortable range for you to throw a treat that far. Some dogs, it's 3 feet away. A lot of people, I think it's a good idea to hold out the treat and go, come on, puppy, it's okay. Come on, good boy. You know, but actually,
if they're
to us humans, that sounds sweet. But to a dog, and then they're conflicted. They're like, I want to go up to this person to get that snack. But I really don't actually want to be that close to them. And so they kind of force themselves to do it, and they'll get the treat, and then they'll retreat. So that's
or accidentally bite.
Because then they're real close, and maybe the person's leaning their face in. And sometimes people that, you know, aren't knowledgeable will give them the treat, and then they'll go, good boy. And then, you know, that's like, you know. So people have, you know, really good intentions when they're trying to make a dog feel better, but coming from the dog's perspective, all that stuff can be really intimidating. So those things being ignored, throwing treats from a distance and building up, and then you'll know that he's comfortable with the person when he makes the decision to come close, not because he's been lured with the treat, but he's actually made. And even then, say he comes close and he's like looking up at you and or at the person and he wants the attention, then it's not okay to then go full on like, good boy, you know? Then still slowly, gently a pet. And so it's, And then think about, like the standing up. So say he was over here and he was getting close to me and then I'm ready to get up. I would either have you go put him back in his crate or I'd throw some treats over there to give him some distance from me before I was going to get up and go to a different room or whatever.
Okay.
So to not, you know, he's standing right here and then not all of a sudden get up.
Over him.
Over him. So, and I was thinking about your boyfriend because obviously that's going to be the next most important person since he also lives here and is interacting with him every day as opposed to a friend that would come over. So is he okay with him when he's okay with him when he's like sitting on the couch and hanging out?
They are great together. They're fine together. It's just when he comes in the door from work.
Okay.
He will get up and just start barking on the couch until Brendan comes over. And I told him because at first, like I said, we were not sure if he had any problem seeing. I said, talk so he can hear your voice and he can hear that it's you.
Before he even comes in the door.
But maybe that's, I don't know if that would be a good idea either. But I just, like, he would come in the door and just start barking. And I would say, just say out loud, hi, Charlie, so he hears your voice. And then as soon as he gets home now, he'll come over to the couch and, like, put his hand out and, like, pet him. And then we're fine. But it's just that initial, like, seeing him. And the thing about him getting up and leaving the room, like, that has not been an issue since, you know, probably the last probably 4 days or so. So it was just kind of at
first. Couple days. That's good.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's so they love each other. They snuggle and he'll have a little, you know, play session with him when he comes home, like last play session of the day.
So I'm thinking about a way for Charlie to know that it's him coming through the door.
So our gate, when you come up those stairs, makes a pretty specific sound, and then the other, like the wooden gate, creaks. So when Steve hears it, he knows Dad's home.
And he gets excited.
But the Charlie, by that time, because it's usually, he's a bartender, so he's usually, you know, doesn't get home till like 1, 2 in the morning.
Oh, okay.
By then, Charlie's usually out.
Okay.
I don't think he hears that cue. He just hears the front door opening, and then all of a sudden is like, oh no!
A few things. One thing you could do is when your boyfriend is home during the day, you could do, just randomly, just be like, hey, go out, come back in, armed with a bunch of treats. And he could try the voice thing. He could try while he's awake and it's a daytime situation.
So it's like saying something while he's outside before he comes inside?
Okay. But see if his hearing, you know, if he could pick that up. Also, I mean, even though it might be okay because your boyfriend was just here and he's gone for a second, he's right back. You know, that might not upset Charlie, but it'll still, it'll, that repetition will just get more and more in his head.
Mm-hmm.
When someone walks through the door, coming and going, good things come.
Yeah.
And it's okay.
Yeah.
Another thing to try, it would be hard if you're asleep and it's like 1 a.m.
Yeah.
I was going to say, if it was a more regular time, would be to have your boyfriend text you and just be like, I'm home. And then you could get Charlie like into another room.
Mm-hmm.
So that your boyfriend can actually come in and get into the house.
Mm-hmm.
Before Charlie's like startled by or surprised by someone coming
okay.
through the door.
Okay.
But of course that would be hard to do if you're asleep.
he usually does text me or call me on his way home, which, you know, gives me like a 20-minute heads up to be ready for him. So yeah,
that's something that you could try. Yeah, having him start out in the kitchen or something.
Okay.
You could give him a few treats and then have your boyfriend also come in with treats, so then it's a different approach.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Rather than
okay.
him being having access to the couch to watch over the door
mm-hmm.
or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay.